So it's interesting tonight. You know, as many of you know, grab a towel. A lot of this teaching is coming out of the book. But I always try in the sessions not just to repeat what it is in the book, you know. So those of you who are reading through the book, you're not just coming to hear the same things regurgitated. But we're actually getting to the part of the book, because the book only came out in May, we're getting to the part of the book that I've not taught on before. So you're getting fresh manna tonight. So I hope that's encouraging and exciting for you. Even as I was preparing, I thought it was going to go in one direction and it went somewhere else. So I hope that's helpful, going to be helpful for you. There's a couple of things we're looking at tonight. I'll let you know what we're looking at. Is this working? Okay, session three. How many of you are not, this isn't to shame anybody, but how many of you have done the first two sessions? We're here for both sessions. Most of you were here for both sessions, weren't you, so far? Session three, next week. You know, this session is really the final session where we're looking at your own personal development, and then we're beginning to transition to say, okay, God has been working in us. So we looked at character a couple of weeks ago, and what it was like to have Christ-like character, etc. And we've been on this journey of personal development. Well, tonight we're looking at a subject called Becoming Deep Wells, and then we're starting to look then at the focus of servant leadership, which is other people. And next week, we're going to start really looking about putting people first, how we as servant leaders, the whole purpose really is that God develops us as followers of Jesus Christ so that we can invest in others. That's what this is all about, isn't it? So tonight, we're looking at two main things, this whole concept of becoming a deep well in order that we can serve this generation. We need to be a spiritual resource. We need to have spiritual resources from within us so that we can serve others effectively. Turn to your neighbor and say, tonight we're going deep. Tonight we're going deep. You see, though, there's a problem. There's a challenge in the world. The challenge is this. One of the challenges that we're seeking to address through this becoming Christ-like servant leadership is the problem of shallowness. There's a problem of shallowness. Have you noticed in the world today, we live in quite a shallow world. When we're talking about becoming a deep well, well, here's the analogy. We know that we live in a continent that over the past 50, 60 years, we've received a lot of aid. There's been a lot of droughts, a lot of famine, a lot of challenges. And if someone comes in and they says, we want to try and help a community, so imagine an impoverished community in a rural area, maybe of Africa, and someone comes in and says, we want to help this community, we're going to dig a well. What you don't want them to do is to dig a shallow well. Because what happens with a shallow well is a shallow well dries up quickly. What is meant to provide long-term sustenance actually becomes futile. It doesn't accomplish the thing for which it's intended for. And sometimes it's like this. It's like in Africa, aid and development has dug a lot of shallow wells. They've not gone to the roots of some of the challenges or the roots of the problems. Aid and charity has created immediate relief, but not created ongoing opportunity for sustainability. The challenge is this. We can also say the church has been like that. Sometimes we've heard it said, the spirituality in this country, in many places in the world, it's like it's a mile wide, but it's an inch deep. We've evangelized. People know the name of Jesus all around the world, but their faith is only an inch deep, so when trials, when problems come, when it's no longer fulfilling their needs or the things that they want, they turn their back on the faith. It's like we've gone, and with our evangelism, we've created shallow wells. Because I believe Jesus wants us to become deep wells, streams of living water that can provide ongoing nourishment. You see, if you go into a community that's famished, that's got famine and drought, and you dig a deep well, that well is going to serve nourishment for generations to come. When you dig deep, you're going to depths of water that even when the rains don't come, you can still bring out the water to grow the plants and to feed the people and to serve a community. Christians, we need to be like that. We need to dig deep. We need to go deep. But we live in a society that actually celebrates shallowness. Have you recognized this? We celebrate shallowness. I'll give you an example. Celebrityism. I don't know how many of you watch celebrity programs, yeah? Celebrity challenges, where these C-grade celebrities that nobody's really heard of, they become famous just for being celebrities. No one really knows why they're a celebrity, but somehow becoming famous has become a thing in itself. As I was preparing for tonight, I was actually looking for some video clips, and I don't have any video clips for you tonight. Ah, okay, first time. I almost did, but then decided not to show it. But I found video clips, and they were just too long, where people teach you how to become famous. So you can go on YouTube, and you can Google how to become famous, and then someone will give you the 5 points of how to become famous. And people want to become famous for becoming famous sake. But you know what? When you're famous just for being famous sake, you're a shallow well, you're a shallow resource, and you don't have the real answers to the problems that people are facing. We've got a shallow generation, a shallowness about us, and we see that, don't we, in the antics of these so-called celebrities, the so-called role models to our children and our young people. That's not the answer, is it? We need people who are walking in the footsteps of Jesus Christ, who are becoming deep wells, who are able to take from deep life experiences and share with others. So we don't want to make a splash, do we? Puddles make a splash. They don't provide long-term relief. What we want to do is we want to go deep. So tonight, grab a towel. We're going deep. We're going deep tonight. And we want you to become deep wells, a spiritual resource that can provide sustenance for the people that you are influencing in your community, in your school, in this church, in the neighborhood, in this city. We're going deep. And what we're going to do for some of our time is we're going to look at the example of the early church. We're going to look at the disciples, Peter and John, from Acts chapter 4, and learn how did they become deep well leaders. How do we know that the disciples? Well, firstly, you know, look at the influence, the impact the disciples had. 11 people, 12 after one was reinstated, changed the world. They changed the world. They started a ripple effect. They weren't just a splash that was here today and gone tomorrow. They were deep. And they started a ripple effect of impact as Jesus said that they would. He said, go into all the world and make disciples, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. We call that the Great Commission. How could they do that? Well, it's because the disciples were now deep wells, full of the Holy Spirit, having the life blood of Jesus flowing through their veins, and they brought transformation, not only to Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, but to the ends of the world. They went deep with Jesus. And they were then able to go broad and have an impact. And we are part of the fruit of that impact. We would not be here today if the disciples were not deep before they went broad. We have the scriptures, the New Testament scriptures today that the Holy Spirit inspired them to write because they had that depth in the Spirit. And now the Word of God has spread to the corners of the earth. So I think if we want to emulate, let's emulate, let's learn from the disciples. And there's one story in particular in Acts chapter 4 that we're early on the days of the New Testament church. And you'll know the story well. In Acts chapter 3, Peter and John had been to the temple, and on the way to the temple, they saw a lame person. The person asked, begged them, and Peter and John said, you know, money we do not have for you, but what we have we give to you. Rise up and walk. And it was a miracle. It was a miracle that caused great attention. It was like suddenly the spotlight was on these disciples. Suddenly they were the people took note of them. They were just normal people on the way to worship at the temple. and through the power of the Holy Spirit, God did something. You know, and at Pentecost had been a couple of days before, that, you know, a few weeks before, the Holy Spirit had come upon them, and suddenly something was happening. Something happened. It was a deep work that was happening. And part of that then, they caught the attention of what was the Sanhedrin, the chief priests, the temple leaders, and they wanted to know what was going on. So they called in Peter and John to give an account in Acts chapter 4. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, Peter and John give testimony to Jesus Christ and the power of Jesus Christ working through them. So there's some things I want to learn from this story. You can go and read the whole story, but some verses that we're going to look at. And what I want to do is explode. I think there are some myths in the church about going deep. And I want to explode those myths tonight to show that all of us in this room have the potential to go deep in Jesus so that then we can have a broad impact in this world. So Father God, we just pray as we turn to your word and look to expound it this evening, that the same Holy Spirit that inspired Peter and John on that day is the Holy Spirit. You are here today among us. And we want you, Jesus, want your Holy Spirit, Father, to continue to bring glory to Jesus in our midst this evening so that we can follow in your footsteps, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. If you open your Bibles to Acts chapter 4, there's a few verses I'm going to look at. Or open your phone apps or wherever you need to look at. The first one, as Peter and John asked to give account to the leaders, the Jewish leaders of the day. We see in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, this is the assessment that the Jewish leaders had of Peter and John. It says, when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And they took note that these men had been with Jesus. It's a beautiful verse. They took note that these men had been with Jesus. These were so-called the intellectuals of the day, the anointed leaders in the temple, the ones who were the most educated. And Peter and John come and give an explanation of this miracle and testify to the work of Jesus in their lives. And these temple leaders, these Jewish scholars are astounded. They took note that these men had been with Jesus. The first myth we see about going deep is that being a deep Christian is only for intellectual Christians. Maybe some of you here today think being a deep Christian, that's just for a certain kind of Christian. They're for the intellectuals. They're for the ones with the big minds. They're for the ones with the titles. You know, they're the ones that go deep in Jesus. They're the ones that become deep well Christians. But then look at the disciples. They were unschooled and ordinary people. And they went deep and they went wide. They were unschooled. What was the distinguishing mark of the disciples? What was it? They had been with Jesus. They had been with Jesus. The key, the truth, is that to become a deep well Christian is all about spending time with Jesus. This is all about developing an intimate relationship with Jesus. You see, when we go closer to Jesus, the depth of Jesus becomes the depth that we draw from. The deep spiritual truths, the deep character. Jesus is the source. So becoming a deep well, the thing that we're talking about, a servant leader of depth, is directly proportional to the time that you spend with Jesus. There's some scriptures here that we can quickly look at from what Jesus himself said in John chapter 4, verse 13 to 14. Jesus said this, everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life. What an incredible promise that you can become a spring of water when we drink from our presence, from being in the presence of Jesus. There's a spring of water that can come within you, that wells up within you, that overflows into society, not just so that good things happen in this life, but that you can have an eternal impact, eternal life. We've looked at that in previous weeks, haven't we? That as Christians, we have that opportunity as Christ-centered servant leaders of having an eternal impact. There's no greater or deeper impact that you can have in the life of any other person than leading them to Jesus and leading them to eternal life. Streams of living water flow out of you that will have an internal impact. How does that happen? It happens through drinking from Jesus, through spending time with him, drinking in his word, and spending your time meditating on the goodness and the love of Jesus. The beautiful thing about this promise of Jesus is who he gave it to initially. This incredible revelation or truth was given to an ordinary Samaritan woman by a well. And Jesus points to the well and says, Samaritan woman, a woman he probably should not have even been communicating with as a Jewish man. And he honors her and says, can you draw some water from this well and give it me to drink? And he said to her, if you knew who you were talking to, you would ask me for a drink. And he gives her this revelation. Jesus gives revelation to you, no matter how ordinary your circumstances. No, this was a woman who had been through six marriages, and was now living in an adulterous relationship. This was a woman who the rest of the world would written off, and Jesus honors and gives her deep truths, deep revelation. So it doesn't matter what your past is. Do not think depth is only for a certain class of Christian. It's not just for something that other people who are so-called holy have done. Jesus said he can make you holy. As you come to him, he will make you holy, and depths can come out of you. Look at another promise that Jesus gives, John 7, verse 37 to 39. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus stood and said in a loud voice, let anyone, anyone who is thirsty, come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of water will flow from within them. He says, anyone, whoever, there is none of us here who are not qualified to become a deep well of spiritual nourishment in Jesus. Everyone, anyone, whomever. I love those words in Scripture. Scripture is the most inclusive book in the universe. Jesus said, I've come so that all who believe in me shall not perish but receive everlasting life. This is not exclusive. This is inclusive. There's rivers of living water available for everyone. And then John 15, verse 1 to 4. Similarly, Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that bears fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. Then he says, verse 4, remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. In our Christian walk, it's not just about a moment of coming to Christ. It's about remaining in Jesus, remaining in him. These promises, they're for everyone. They're for all of you. We can all become deep wells as we, in proportion to spending time with Jesus. This man, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was killed by Hitler a few weeks before the end of the Second World War. He'd resisted, he'd been in prison, and he continued to preach the gospel and bear witness to Jesus, even in that evil regime, and it eventually cost him his life. What was the secret that he had to be a deep well to sustain? And actually, I've read the testimony of this man as he was taken to the gallows. And someone said of him, he was at peace. Even though he was being executed, he was at peace. What was his secret to be a deep well? Even under that amount of persecution, it was this. Our hearts have room only for one all-embracing devotion. And we can only cleave to one Lord. Every competitor to that devotion must be hated. Do we love Jesus? And by comparison, because of our love to Jesus, it's almost as if, not that we do hate others, but Jesus himself said, you should love me so much. He said in Luke 14, verse 26, You know, by comparison, you know, we need to love him as our deepest love. By comparison, everything else is hated. We love him so much. When we have that devotion to Christ, we become a deep well. We become a source of sustenance for others. That's the first thing that we learn from the disciples. They had been with Jesus. Are you with Jesus? Are you living with Jesus? We can only serve others if we have that vibrant relationship. What did he say? All embracing devotion. All embracing devotion to Jesus. Then come what may, even on the gallows, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer found, you can still stand at peace because we have that all embracing devotion. The second thing we see from Acts chapter 4 is that servant leaders become deep wells by persevering through suffering. The second myth, is spiritual or deep Christians are immune from suffering. There's some teaching that goes around, doesn't it, that almost it's if you're going through hard times, you begin to feel guilty that maybe you've done something wrong or there's sin in your life. But actually, as Christians, we are not immune from suffering. Rather, as deep Christians, deep well Christians, we persevere through suffering. We persevere through these things. We see it with the disciples. In Acts 4, verse 18, then they called the Sanhedrin, the leaders, the Jewish leaders, then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. And this was the start of persecution. As you continue to read through Acts, we see that suffering followed as they continued to remain obedient to Jesus. Their depth in Jesus also meant it led them through times of great trials. When Stephen was stoned, it said the church were in deep grief. They learned what it was to go through deep grief, but they still counted it all joy for the sake of the gospel. You see, the truth is this. Christians become deep wells by persevering through suffering, by persevering through hardship. Think of David. I'm going to read from Psalm 42. Incredible psalm of David in verse 6 and 7. Psalm 42, David is going through a really deep, difficult time. His faith even seems to be on the edge. You know, we don't exactly know the circumstances that he was going through at that particular time. It could have been any of the circumstances of David's life that he was going through. Numerous times of hardship. It might have been Saul trying to pin him against the wall, or him having to run and flee into other lands and pretend to be mad in order to survive. It may have been later in his life when his own son rebelled against him, or perhaps in the grief of having recognized his sin after he'd had the affair with Bathsheba. Maybe it was one of those occasions, we don't know which, but in this particular instance, there is a deep loss and grief that is going on in David. And he says this, my soul is downcast within me. Therefore, I will remember you from the land of the Jordan, the heights of Hermon from Mount Mizar. Then he says this, deep calls to deep. In the roar of your waterfalls, all your waves and breakers have swept over me. But then he ends the psalm. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will yet praise him, my Savior and my God. Even in the midst of this deep trial, he was clinging on. Yet I will praise you. Yet I will hope. You see, in the depth of our despair, we learn something about the depth of God's grace and his mercy in our lives. There are two things to underline here, two additional facts from Psalm 46. 2 verse 6 and 7. The fact one is God does allow us to go through deep trials. He does allow us to go through deep trials. It is not pleasant. Hebrews 12 verse 11 says no discipline is pleasant at the time, but God disciplines those whom he loves. And he allows the trials as a form of discipline to grow us, to understand more of him. But you know, being a deep well leader doesn't mean you go looking for the trials. I'm not saying now all of you go out there and look to be miserable. Let's look for suffering. No.
But in the fact is, in this life, there will be trouble, Jesus said. It's a promise of Jesus. It's like his statement, but he says the additional part of that promise, do not fear, I have overcome the world. So we do not have to be overcome by the trials, but we will go through these trials. We are not immune to it. You don't have to enjoy it. David wasn't having fun. We don't laugh it off and say it's water off a duck's back. You know, we don't try and be super spiritual about these things. David was real. Why so downcast? I'm depressed. I don't like this. But yet, the deep will call out to deep. What's the second deep? The first deep was the depth of his suffering. The second deep is the unfathomable depths of God. God is unfathomably deep. No matter how deep you go in your suffering or in your trials, God is even deeper. God is even deeper than that. He is there. He is there in that, and we learn things we don't always understand. He doesn't even always explain to us why we're going through these things. But when we have to persevere through trials, what we learn is he is already there. He is in that place. Why can we know that? Because God himself watched his own son, Jesus Christ, die on the cross. He has faced the most unfathomably deep suffering, more than any of us could imagine or even begin to understand, on that cross. And when we go through our sufferings, it's just an insight, a glimpse of what Jesus has actually gone through already. He's already been there. He's been through it. And we can't explain it. I think I've mentioned in this church that I went through some deep suffering a couple of years ago. And I know you as a church understand these things, when my late wife passed away. And part of my recovery time of that period is learning about how God relates to me as my ally in my time of grief. One of the things I took up doing was surfing during that time. I don't look like a surfer, do I? Like, you're all looking at me and thinking, you know. But I go to Muizenberg with my surfboard. And a longboard that someone has got, and I catch some waves, you know. But the thing is, I stay fairly safe. I don't go out onto the deeper waves, you know, the people on the back line. Are there any surfers here? The ones who really go out on the back line, and they get the really long waves. And you see, when you go out into the deeper water, it's a little bit intimidating. It's a little bit scary. But actually, the rewards are even greater. You learn something in that. And the sea for me became a great place of healing. And what it reminds me of is this. When you're surfing on that back line, you've got that mixture of fear, awe, and joy. Sometimes when we go through the deep sufferings, we understand the depths of God and we're in awe at him. There's even what the Bible talks about, fear of him, the incredible depths of God that we don't fully understand. And yet when we experience his grace in that circumstance, it can lead to deep joy, real joy, that says, and yet I will praise him. That is what it means to be a deep well leader. Deep calls to deep. From the depths of our despair, we call out to the depths of God's love. Knowing that while both these things, both the deep suffering and the depth of God's grace, are in some ways unexplainable, but God still works through the depths of our despair in order to help us experience the depths of his love. And you know, the beautiful thing about this is when you've been in those deep places, you no longer make shallow responses to people who are also going through suffering. And servant leaders, I'm speaking to your servant leaders, influences. You know, let's not give people pat answers. Let's not just explain things away with Christian jargon. You know, or praise the Lord anyway. You know, or just dismiss people. People are going through deep stuff in the world. They want to understand that we can't explain it all. But there is a deeper God that we can draw them into and say we can still find peace in that place. Though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will not fear evil. Why? Because he is with us. Something I've learned is that we don't bypass suffering. God is with us through the suffering. He doesn't help us ignore it or find a way around it. He is there with us in the midst of it. And we can serve other people by standing with them at their point of greatest need, not ignoring their pain, but bringing Jesus into it with them and then helping them through it the other side. That's the deep response, an opportunity to serve deeply. And we see that with the disciples who persevered, even though the Sanhedrin said, shut up, stop speaking. And then they said, what can we do? We've got to obey God. They went out, they started preaching straight away. Well, the next time, let's whip them. Shut up, don't speak anymore. They went out and they preached again. What's the next thing they do? We start stoning them. What happens? The gospel starts spreading to the ends of the earth. It moves from Jerusalem and starts going. The more that they persecuted, the deeper the pain that came against them, the deeper they went into Jesus, and the more they obeyed. Because what else could they do? What else could they do? The third thing, after this, in Acts chapter 4, when the disciples have been dismissed by the Sanhedrin, the first thing they do, it says, on their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all that the chief priests and the elders had said to them. And then there's a great prayer. I'm not going to read it now. There's a prayer that they pray of faith. Then in verse 32, it says, all the believers were in one heart and one mind. No one claimed that any of their possessions was their own, but they shared everything that they had. There's a myth about being deep, that we go deep by isolating ourselves. You know, sometimes when we talk about a Christian, we think, oh, that person's a deep Christian. What we mean is they spend hours in books. We mean they're boring Christians, you know. They're isolating themselves in their ivory tower, and they're getting full of knowledge, and they know all the stuff. They have all the theological arguments and debates. But that is not what we're talking about. What the disciples did is they learned together in community. Deep leaders become deep wells through relationship with other Christians. We're called to be family. We're called to be together in this. We see what the disciples, their deep response was, they were in one heart and one mind. We've seen this before. Jesus said, by your love for one another, people will know that you are my disciples. We don't go deep. I'm not against head knowledge. You know, I've studied myself. But that is not the answer. That is not what God is looking for. It can be a part. It can be a part, a contribution to the body of Christ so that we can all grow up into the head, which is Jesus Christ. You know, the studying is an important part of that. But that is not what it means. We all know that some people, don't we? They've got incredible theological knowledge. They've got incredible head knowledge. But are they any good when you want someone to pray with you? We know that some people, they're so full of knowledge that actually they've lost their heart for people. People, we need one another. I'm not going to belabor this point because we're going to start looking at this further in other sections, but we grow in depth in as much as we have relationship with one another. Proverbs 27, verse 17 says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man may sharpen another. You know, it's a violent thing. We sharpen each other, you know? To change the analogy, as one person kind of gets their shovel and digs into your life, you know, you get deeper because we're interacting, we're out of relationship. We're spurring, that Hebrews 10, verse 24, 25 says, spur one another on. Cheer one another on towards love and good works. We need to go together in this. Apostle Paul says we're like a body, doesn't he? Where each of us needs to play our own part. There are different gifts, there are different talents, there are different, you know, different opportunities. Each of them have a role to play in the kingdom, in the body of Christ. We go deep through Christian community. We need one another. The fourth thing, oh, those are those verses we've just looked at. The fourth thing then, as we read then what happened in Acts 34, verse 33 to 35. With great power, the apostles continued to testify to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And God's grace was so powerfully at work in them all. There's a myth that says going deep is a selfish pursuit. It's about self-gratification. It's about pride. It's about, as Paul said in the scriptures, about becoming super apostles, that we go deep to somehow become a better class of Christian. That's not what we see with the disciples. Rather, we go deep wells so we can better serve others. It's not going spending time with Jesus, doing these other things we've talked about, going through deep trials, these things that God allows us to go through. having Christian community, the purpose is not so that we ourselves become fat and useless, but that actually we have the opportunity to have energy for mission and to serve others. We could become deep wells. Deep wells are all about serving others. You see, fruitfulness. This we see here, tremendous fruitfulness. It says there was no needy person among them. There was a witness that was happening in Acts chapter 4 that was having an influence across the whole city. People were being added to their number daily, it says in Acts chapter 2. There was growth, there was health, the deep relationship that they had with Jesus, the deep wells that they were, meant that there was fruitful ministry. There was fruitful ministry that was taking place. There's a beautiful picture of this. And if you'd allow me to read this, it's in Ezekiel chapter 47. And it's the river from the temple. It's a vision that the angel of God gave to Ezekiel. I think this sums this up beautifully. Let me read a few verses of this for you and just try and picture this in your mind. The man brought me back to the entrance to the temple, and I saw water coming out from the under the threshold of the temple towards the east, for the temple faced east. The water was coming down from under the south side of the temple, south of the altar. The altar is the place of worship. Just note that. He then brought me out through the north gate and led me around the outside to the outer gate facing east, and the water was trickling from the south side. As the man went eastward with a measuring line in his hand, he measured off 1,000 cubits and then led me through water that was now ankle deep. He measured off another 1,000 cubits and led me through water that was knee deep. He measured off another thousand, and led me through water that was up to my waist. He measured off another 1,000, but now it was a river that I could not cross because the water had risen and was deep enough to swim in, a river that no one could cross. He asked me, "Son of man, do you see this?" Then he led me back to the bank of the river. When I arrived there, I saw a great number of trees on each side of the river. He said to me, "This water flows towards the eastern region and goes down into the Arabah, where it enters the Dead Sea. When it empties into the sea, the salty water there becomes fresh. Swarms of living creatures will live wherever the water river flows. There will be large numbers of fish because this water flows there and makes the salt water fresh. So where the river flows, everything will live." And it goes on to describe, "Fruit trees of all kinds will grow on both banks of the river. Their leaves will not wither, nor will their fruit fail. Every month they will bear fruit because the water from the sanctuary flows to them. Their fruit will serve for food and their leaves for healing." What a beautiful picture. As the water came out from the presence of God, from the temple. Remember, who are we now? We are the temple. We are living temples, serving at the altar. Through worshiping Jesus, the presence of Jesus, as we spend more time, the water begins to flow and becomes deep. And as it combines with together in Christian community, the depth of the water grows. It moves up and becomes something that we can't even wade across or swim across. There's a depth that goes. And where does it go? It goes out into the desert land, into the parched land, into the Dead Sea. The Dead Sea in our community, the Dead Sea in Woodstock, the Dead Sea in Cape Town, the place of dryness and destruction, where nothing healthy grows, and it transforms. It doesn't just make a little bit of difference. It completely transforms. It does a miracle where the Dead Sea, the salty water where nothing grows, becomes fresh water. And that fresh water is living water that out of which comes a harvest. There's fish that swims in it. There's trees that grow, and there's food that sustains for generation after generation. That is the picture of why we go deep, so that we can become fruitful and having that transformative effect. We saw it began at the temple, at the altar, and how it flowed out and the impact that it had. Our fruitfulness, the long-lasting fruitfulness, will be directly proportional to the depth that we have. We need to go deep. Jesus himself said, as we abide in him, in John chapter 15, we will have much fruit. Who wants to have much fruit? Who wants to see much fruit? Who wants to see the Dead Sea become fresh water. We have that opportunity through Jesus flowing through us going deep with him, becoming deep wells. To close, I want to look at some practical, and then we're going to have a time just to a chance to respond. And as I said, it's a new talk. The problem with a new talk is I don't know how long it's going to last. So there's a portion that you'll have to go and read in the book. But practically, there has to be a question we need to ask ourselves. So there's some of the notes I've skipped on. Practically, how do we become deep wells? Some of you might be here and saying, Tim, I want this. I want this, but it feels like my well is blocked. There are things that have happened in my life where I don't feel I'm drawing from those streams of living water anymore. You know what? In the old days, the well was the wellspring of life. And a community required that well for fresh water. So in battle or in times when you're facing enemies, one way to completely destabilize a community, the enemy would come and block up the wells or pollute the wells. And the people would starve. Can you imagine the impact when the well is blocked upon the families, upon the communities? So the number one tactic of the enemy, or a major tactic of the enemy, is to try and block our wells. Yes, we're still believers. Yes, we're still attending church with certain things, but we're not drawing. We're no longer, you know, our wells are blocked. Our wells are polluted. We're not going deeper in our relationship with Jesus, so we're not having a broad impact in the world. And I think we need to do a well health check every now and then and say, is there anything that is blocking my well? Is there any reason why maybe I'm not being fruitful? And my list here now are some practical things. It's not exhaustive. There might be other things that have blocked your wells. But maybe there's some things tonight that you can commit to say, I want to see my well unblocked in order that I can be effective and productive as a Christ-centered servant leader so I can grab a towel and have an impact in the world. The first thing that can block our well is habitual sin. And the lie of habitual sin, of getting involved in sin, is that the devil lies and says there's no way out. He uses it to accuse us. And every time we repeat offense, he says, look at you. And our well feels blocked. We no longer connect to Jesus in the way that we used to. But you know what? Jesus has given us a simple way to unblock from habitual sin. We unblock through confession. Jesus said, those who confess their sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But he also says in the scriptures, we must confess our sins to one another. And I think this is something that is critical to have our wells unblocked. If you're struggling with habitual sin, find a trusted person that you can confess to, who can pray with you, who can stand with you to help overcome the stronghold that has on your life. It's a simple phrase that I say that once you've spoken your sin, its power is broken. You will not be rejected. People will love you and they will still accept you. Jesus does not reject you. So how on earth can his followers reject you? Confess your sins to one another and he will restore you. Your well will become unblocked. Whatever that habitual sin you're struggling with, confess. Speak it. Speak it to Jesus. Speak it to someone. We said we're in community, didn't we? And a lot of these are going to be about community. A lot of these blockages, the solution is found actually in community. Community with Jesus, the Trinity, and with one another. The second blockage is busyness. We block our wells through busyness. And maybe it's the curse of our age. It used to be, how are you? I'm fine. And I'm guilty of this as next person. Now it's, how are you? Oh, busy. It's the standard response, isn't it? It's the curse of our age. And we're all accustomed. It's a problem all of us face. And what does busyness do? It blocks us from spending time with Jesus. It blocks us from finding that spring of living water, and we find that we're having to survive from our own energy, our own resources. How many of us suffer from depression and despair because we're trying to carry on through our own resources rather than coming back to the source of life, and remaining in Him? We unblock through devotion to Jesus. Come back to Him. Spend time with Him. There are some wonderful Christian resources out there now that can help you through this. Devotional materials, the scriptures, worship music. There are things, there's so much out there, but actually sometimes it just adds to our busyness. What we have to do is reorder our lives. Find a way to begin again your devotion. Fall in love with Jesus again. Start dating Jesus again. Rediscover that first love that you had for Him. He said that about the Revelation Church, didn't he? The one thing I have against you is you've lost that first love. It's a blockage. We can be so busy doing the things of the church that actually our wells are blocked. We're running from our own giftedness. How much more could we do if we have the devotion of Jesus Christ? We block our wells by isolating ourselves. Even some of us, we think we're being super spiritual by isolating ourselves. But also through disunity, we've taken offense at someone. We unblock that well through communion. Communion with one another. And what I mean by this, fellowship, hospitality, hanging out with each other. I've always said before, the biggest tool in the tool belt of a Christ-centered servant leader is food. Sharing meals together. If you're isolating yourself, maybe you've been hurt. Maybe you've been broken. Maybe there are words that have been spoken over your life. They've blocked you and you've isolated. You know you've done it. You've blocked your heart. Start opening that heart up again. Trust again. Maybe you'll be hurt again. But actually, surely communion and becoming a deep well and fellowship is worth the risk than isolating ourselves and surviving rather than thriving. It's a hard thing, we know. Relationships are tough sometimes. But God has called us into that, and His bride together find that unity in Him. It's a beautiful thing. Some of us, we've blocked our wells because we have no self-discipline. We don't know when to say yes. We don't know when to say no. Most of us, actually, we don't know how to say no to things. There's no self-discipline in the things we eat. We come to January, and every year we start our exercise plan, you know. And I believe that we block our wells when we don't look after ourselves holistically, body, soul, and spirit. We've got to look after ourselves in all who we are holistically. And yet, we allow ourselves, maybe we think we're tending to ourselves spiritually by coming to church. But God is saying, are you looking after my temple? Are you looking after your heart? Are you disciplining yourself in spiritual disciplines of prayer and Bible reading? Are you disciplining yourselves in physical disciplines of exercise and healthy living? If we want to be able to serve people effectively, we need to guard our hearts and our minds and our bodies as the temple of the Spirit, so we can serve people with love and energy in good health and sound mind. What is the answer to unblock this world? Accountability. Don't try and do it alone. If you've got a goal, if you've got something that you want to grow in, if you want to develop a healthy lifestyle goal, ask someone to hold you accountable to that goal. It's the same, similar, I know, to the habitual sin, but self-discipline is not necessarily about sinfulness. It's just about unwise choices that we're making. So take bite-sized chunks at the things that you're trying to do. You know what they say, you don't eat the elephant all at once, you eat the elephant one bite at a time. Find the next bite and ask someone to help you to make that bite. And slowly you find your way, making your way through that elephant that you never felt you could get through. Self-discipline. Accountability. We know in our own, I don't know about you, I'm prone to laziness. I don't know if any of you are Discovery Vitality members, but getting this Apple Watch was not a status thing for me. It was an accountability thing. You know, if I don't get a certain number of points every week, I have to start paying for this watch. So I'm accountable to Discovery, who gave me this watch, that if I don't get enough points through exercise plan, you know, there's some days, last Thursday, pouring with rain, but I need 300 points that day. And I went out on a run in that storm. I was drenched. I got home. I had to take my stuff off outside the house because I was so drenched. But I was accountable to something. I would have been prone to laziness. You know, we're all prone to laziness, aren't we? Accountability helps us. Accountability partners can help you. The final thing. Some of us have simply stopped digging. We've reached a point in our Christian lives and we think, you know what? I'm doing okay. I'm doing okay. And my challenge to you is maybe there's more. Maybe there's greater depths. You know, there's parts of the ocean that are so deep that we've still not mapped them. Humanity has still not mapped parts of the ocean in this technical age. There's parts of the ocean that are so deep and so dark that nothing could ever get down there. You know, the Lord, he is so deep, unfathomably so. There's so much more to him in this life for us. Start digging again. And one of the ways we can do this is to get excited about winning people to Jesus once more. When we realize that there's a lost world out there, we realize actually we can do nothing in ourselves. I need to dig the depths of Jesus so that I can serve the world through salvation. Because he can do that work. But he asks us to join him in it as his deep wells. So the challenge this evening is grab a towel. We've looked at a number of things. This was the part we're going to skip. We've looked at deep well, servant leaders, spend time with Jesus. We looked that we become deep wells by persevering through suffering. We've seen that deep well servant leaders require Christian community and a lot of those blockages. You saw how much we depend and need one another to remain unblocked, to keep on digging deeper. And we become deep wells so we can serve others. In fact, our fruitfulness will be directly proportional to our depth in him. So Christ-centered servant leaders, they grab a towel and they serve others by becoming deep well leaders, able to empower others from generation to generation. And then we become part of the Great Commission, don't we? Because Jesus said we're to go out and make disciples. What does that mean? We want to replicate other deep well leaders. The Apostle Paul said, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. We want you to be people that you can say to the people around you who you're discipling, follow my example as I follow the example of Christ. And the example we want them to follow is surely someone who is plummeting the depths of the love of Christ. That's the greatest example we can show. So we thought we'd close tonight with a song. Christina. And there's only one song we can sing in response to this, along with David, as deep cries out to deep. But maybe just use this song in your own heart and your own mind to once again commit to this and to say, what are the things, where are the places where you're asking God to unblock your well? What are the things that you need to do as a commitment, as deep calls out to deep, as deep calls out to deep, the commitment that you can make to the Lord tonight to say, I want my well unblocked. I want to go again into the depths of the love of Jesus so that I can serve others more effectively in the world. Amen.